Members in the meeting who would like to speak? Thank you very much. So for this speaker, Councillor Tracy O'Brien.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. I'd like to speak within my time on three things. First of all, as Chair of Planning, I have already asked the Mayor that some of the things that we are dealing with in planning will be brought up with the working group. I'm sure it will. But I want to highlight things about what can be done through planning, and obviously that can only be done where we have got new development. But where we have got new development, if trees go, we nearly always replace them with two trees. On bigger developments, we get section 106, this has already been brought up by Councillor Radford. Already a lot of that money has been spent. I think we're having a misconception planted here that we're not doing anything with that money. It's actively being spent. I have in my own ward a green space that's been newly provided as a result of section 106, and that's repeated throughout the city. But more of that will be happening. There's going to be a new legislation, which I am sure will go through, so that planning can also demand biodiversity gain. This will be additional to section 106. So all the initiatives that we've already got in our report about green corridors, we can add to those where we've got new planning development along those routes. But we can also add to the routes that are there from planning developments that are slightly further afield. So no planning in the future should give us a biodiversity loss. And if I could just give one simple example of that. It's now been proposed nationally that once this legislation comes in, the whole of HS2 has to have green corridors crossing it to allow the great crested newt to move about this country. All right, maybe you might not think that's a big deal. I think it is a big deal because it allows a lot of other wildlife to move as well. The other thing I wanted to bring up is myself, Councillor Hurley and Councillor Crone are all on the Liverpool City Region Combined Authority in overview and scrutiny. And if this Mersey barrage comes through, all our power needs could be served for the whole region, not just Liverpool City, and hopefully that would give us green energy. However, it brings me on finally to all these things sound fantastic in theory, but in practice they're so much harder to put into place. And I can't remember who it was who said, you've got to make a start on this, there's bound to be problems. I couldn't agree more. But until you face those problems, challenges make you stronger when you overcome them. So hopefully that barrage, with all the environmental other problems it could bring, will actually find a way through all of that. Thank you.
Thank you. Councillor Brown.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. Every day before I self out of my house, my six-year-old daughter leaves you asking me what I'm up to for the day. Of course, I tell her that I'm off to a council meeting and we'll be home late. She then says to me, oh, is that the council? Is that the place where the big red chairs and we all shouted at each other across the room? And usually, unfortunately, I would say yes. But on this occasion, I said, actually, we're going to be working together to save the planet for her and for everyone that she knows. So can I say how pleased I am that we're having this talk today and working cross-party to achieve some real outcomes, and long may it continue. Well, Mayor, as the motion before us says, the built environment contributes around half the UK's total carbon footprint. Almost half of this is from energy used in buildings, For example, plug loads, TVs, washing machines, electric heaters, cooking, etc. There will be some that will argue it is not the built environment industry's responsibility to address this energy being used. But heating alone results in 10% of the nation's carbon footprint, and homes are more significant than all other building types put together. How we decarbonise our heat supply is one of the big policy challenges. There are some small, low-cost individual steps we could take as a local authority to help with this, such as enforcing the minimum energy efficiency standards in the private rental sector, or working with energy companies to target fuel poor or vulnerable households with energy efficient measures. We could go much wider than this, and although it would be at a significant cost, as the Mayor has alluded to before, to look at retrofit all council-owned properties, whether that's houses, schools, offices, even this brand old town hall that we're sitting in, now for an energy performance certificate grade C or higher. But when we're talking about the built environment and how it affects the climate, it's not just about the in-use issues I've spoken about, but it's about building altogether and making sure that we are building the right type of properties in the right places in this city. One of the things I'm pleased to see in this proposed commitment to this motion is the line that we will commit council to coordinate conversation with individuals, organisations and communities across the city about threats to their livelihoods and the health of climate change. This conversation, this partnership, absolutely has to extend to people when we're talking about new developments, whether it be new houses or commercial space. We need a community-led, not a developer-led approach to reshaping our city and tackling climate change. Major planning applications will almost always generate concern from the local community, and in some cases, maybe we've also in park and woods, will quite often and quite rightly promote strong feelings. That said, we can't ignore the challenge of building new homes, schools and health provisions that come with an increasing population. That's why I think it's so important that development should provide what areas need most of identified through the local plan. And if discussions about infrastructure can happen at this stage, they can lead to a more positive outcome, such as protecting vulnerable parks, improving spaces, but also about fulfilling the development need for a growing population. As I only have a few minutes to speak on this element here, but I think we have a responsibility to get this right, for not just for our generations, but for the future of humanity itself. But change won't happen if it's top down. That's why it's so important that we work with communities individuals to change the
built
environment.
Thank you.
A point of in the debate and the discussion was clear, and I think Councillor Collins, in a contribution, understands that we will have debates around the built environment, air quality, and all those issues, which then will be fed back to Council. The fact that we're having a council meeting tonight around climate change just means to say we won't have a council whenever talk about this particular issue again. But the select committee and the work stream will pick up on those particular areas where we'll have a much more in-depth discussion. Advisors and people who can give us information on what can, what can't be done, but also the impact, either positive or negative, in what we do. And an example of that, and Councillor Jean is not in the chamber at this moment, but she made and alluded to before about the cruise liner terminal, and Councillor Mumby in this contribution did too, around tourism and the impact of tourism. And tourism is a £4.5 billion revenue for the whole city region, 4,500 jobs just in Liverpool alone, 45,000 jobs across the whole city region is what's at stake. And she touched on the cruise liner terminal. With our cruise liner terminal, we're looking at that connecting ships that dock here into our own generating system, so they shut down their engines. But if we don't get that right and we want to ban cruise liners coming to Liverpool, then we don't want to end with that. Let's ban cargo ships coming into Seaport. Let's ban cargo ships going to Garston, where we import food, animal feed, more than anywhere else. Let's ban tankers going to Stanlow. Let's ban ships going to be fitted out or built in Camel Airs. And we're talking literally hundreds of thousands of jobs dependent on those particular industries. So if we're going to do something, we have to be very, very careful about what we do. Because I tell you this, the cruise liners would love nothing more than to
go to Cardiff or travel up to Glasgow or go across to Newcastle or go somewhere else. We get 85 ships coming in a year in this city. Southampton, 3,500 ships a year going in. So we have to be absolutely careful about what we do. And that's why the debate should take place in the actual committees that are linked to the select committee, so we can have an informed debate and discussion.
Thank you very much, sir. Councillor Robinson Collins.
Congratulations. Thank you very much, Lord Mayor. I think I'll speak now just to try and beat the system slightly, but also to have a little go at correcting the gender imbalance in the speakers tonight, so I have to do a bit on that bit. Really welcome this motion and this declaration. It's a really welcome step. It shows a massive commitment from the council. So thanks to everyone for their work that's all gone onto the motion and the work streams and setting all this stuff out so far. I want to particularly thank as well our colleagues from the Youth Climate Strike. They've run a fantastic campaign. Great speech before, but well done to them for keeping the pressure on us as politicians over the past few months. And good luck with your campaign, you're doing a fantastic job on that. It is of course easier to declare climate emergency than to deliver it, as others have mentioned. And it will require a massive amount of work for everyone to change their behaviour and to make that commitment. It can't be down to the council though, but the council of course can make a big difference and it will be doing so. So welcome all the work streams, but certainly I'm going to speak a little bit about reducing waste, so sorry if I say beating the system, but you confused me. Currently reducing waste is an absolutely urgent requirement, as some of my colleagues have alluded to. That is something I've been going on about for some time. Thanks to David Attenborough for absolutely making it a thing, so it's become a bit more trendy to be talking about it. It's not just about plastics, massive issue with reducing plastics, of course, and when these ones run out at the back of the room in the town hall, we will be remembering to bring our own bottles, also get a china cup from the tea room there, because we won't be buying any more single-use plastics within the council.
More proud and heat up. We need to ensure that we have the capacity to accommodate everyone
and for the city's infrastructure to cope with the added pressures on energy use, water supply, drainage, food and breathable air. If, and it's been, as it's been suggested in a new analysis published in the last couple of weeks, that by the year 2050 London's climate will resemble Madrid's today, I know the displacement of fossil then arrive in Madrid, then cities in the UK will need to rethink our built environment quite significantly. We need far more green infrastructure, as we know green spaces cool hot cities as well as capture carbon. No more cutting down trees in the city centre, we'll need to be planting them instead. Liverpool One, for example, is an excellent example of the kind of sterile built-up area that desperately needs more greenery and biodiversity. Even some of the grass there is artificial. Living rooms or walls should become commonplace, but green infrastructure isn't just about cooling, it's also about flood prevention. Our Victorian drainage system struggled to cope with the sun downpour at the best of times. We won't be just getting hotter summers, of course, but wetter winters too and more extreme weather events. We need to rethink the vast acres of tarmac and concrete that seal us from the earth. We need to investigate alternatives wherever possible. Certain materials punctuate for planting in ever more pedestrianised areas. Do we want to devote more space to cars or more space to people? Does that road need to be as wide, or can we give up that space to pedestrians, cyclists or play streets? And what alternatives can we use to surface them? Can we develop our district centres better to avoid the need to travel to the city for work and leisure? Cutting carbon through commuter travel would be a big win, but it involves investment in other parts of the town. Improve each area's local offer, encourage remote working, but provide the good public amenities beyond the city centre to ensure people actually want to do that. And that, of course, goes hand in hand with thriving local communities. It's hard to know whether transport policies and the built end and the built environment start. It's a clear example of why these things can't. All these projects can't be considered in isolation, but we need to look at the big picture and how everything links together. There are, of course, limitations to what planning conditions we can assist on flood control, and this is the reason why Secretary Government needs to act too. Stringent standards for new builds will be essential. The Council can effectively set its own standards for any buildings created by the new foundations company, and these, of course, should be benchmark-settingly high. There's nothing to stop Liverpool social housing from becoming the most energy-efficient dwellers in the region. Insulating our older buildings is also a must and will bring benefits.
Councillor James, can you?
Just one
more. No, right up, please.
And well-being to be said before, as well as reducing food poverty, we need to be bold and start a wide-reaching retrofit campaign, and there's no reason why conservation of our city heritage can't go hand in hand with new technology. So this is a really exciting and daunting time. As towns and cities around the world are declaring a climate emergency, I feel confident that together we can take huge strides in a short space of time to mitigate the worst effect of the climate chaos that is beginning to unfold. One team, one council, thinking globally but acting locally. Thank you all.
Thank you, Dorman. Welcome me, the motion, and I particularly welcome the point where it says incorporate the sustainable development goals into city council policies and reflect the SDG within the strategy work. Can I just ask as well that we all look at the inclusive growth plan and actually embed all those 17 SDGs across that plan, because that would make a massive difference. I'm not going to read them out now, but if people look at them and go back through the SDGs, they're really, really good. Okay, they also talk about planet, people, prosperity, peace and partnership, which is really important there. Just want to say thank you so much to London and Matilda, who I thought they did a brilliant speech there. And just one of the quotes that they made, it said, please make a note of the pronoun we, that's us, accepting responsibility as members of a capitalist and consumerist society, demanding everything in excess with no regard to the destruction we are causing. A strange link which people might not be aware, income inequality happens in where you have capitalist countries and you have very low wages and you have high wage income for some people. And one of the side things that happens with that is that consumerism increases dramatically because people are judged on what they earn and what they own, and therefore they want to have the latest thing, and they want to have the biggest houses or the biggest cars or whatever it is, and that increases it. So just to finish on, I'd like to encourage us today, because we actually have got a cross-party consensus on this, and just picking up some off from across the pond, Obama's great line and strapline about together we can, so I think we can. Thank you very much.
Thank you. And the final contributor on this theme, Councillor James Roberts.
Thank you. in 2011 what was described at the time as the Arab Spring. This was in no small part caused by the ravages of climate change, simply because in 2008, 9 and 10 there were droughts caused by climate change, which resulted in food shortages, which led to instability and led to riots. And by 2011, we saw revolutions occur in Tunisia and then in Egypt. We also saw civil wars in Libya and Syria. And as a result of this, we've had up to 4 million refugees, which has caused a crisis of solidarity for those refugees across Europe. The UN's estimated that by 2050 there might be as many as 200 million of these climate refugees. So if you think we've had a crisis of solidarity so far, then imagine how bad it might get by 2050. And that's why we've got to take action now, because my colleague, Councillor Hayden, is right to point out that it affects the global southwest, as usual. I'm also dubious about the ability of capitalism as a system to deliver either social or climate justice. So what can we actually do here in Liverpool? I'm really proud that colleague Laura has been appointed to the position of cabinet member in this brief. I know that she'll continue to push and do everything she can to make sure that we get the best possible outcomes. I know that here in Liverpool we've already taken a number of measures. I'm proud of the City Bike Scheme, which encourages people to get off their cars and improves public health. The LED streetlight system, it's reduced our carbon emissions by 82% in that area. We've been spreading wildflowers to make sure that our pollinators have somewhere to live. We've supported patchwork farms, we've introduced compost bins, we've taken lots and lots of positive and radical steps. There's always so much more we can do. We need to look for best practice around the world. We've got lots of plans already, but if you look at places like Melbourne with their sustainable buildings programme, if you look at Mexico City with their air quality programme, if you look at Munich, they've got green municipal energy plans. The place where I'm most inspired of all to look for ideas is with our youth climate strikers. I was really proud to help facilitate their strike in March. I attended their joint action meeting and then helped to crowd steward their protest in town. I couldn't help but be impressed by the sheer amount of passion on display and just how knowledgeable they were about the issue. I'll be looking in that direction for the actual practical steps we can take here in the court. So it's incumbent on all of us to work together on this issue. We really do, because it's not like we have any other choices. You know, if we've got one time, we have to get this right.
Can I just make a request, please, to members that we stick to the theme? Some people are tending to drift off a little bit, and we'll all get the chance to speak tonight, and you'll certainly get the chance to speak in the new select committee. So, can you please stick to the theme? Thank you. So, the next theme and the debate is waste and resources, and again, this is your video to be played.